Church, say amen. Try that one more time. Let the church say amen.
Amen.
What a blessing it is to be back in the house of God tonight.
Yes, sir.
We've come to the Thursday night of this week, the second to the last night of the meeting, and we appreciate your presence. A good crowd here tonight.
Amen.
Very encouraged by your presence, and I trust that you had wonderful day today, and that God has been good to you. And whether you admit it or not, I know He has been good to you. I'm looking at you right now, and I know that God has been good. And we must always give God the props that He so richly deserves, because as Luke said, it is through Him that we live, move, and have our very being. And when you think about it, when you seriously think about it, there is nothing that you can do without the grace of God in your life.
Amen.
Nothing at all. I have a dear friend at home. I grew up with this guy, and they called me today and got two messages, two troubling messages. Well, one was troubling. The other was a little bit better news. But the first message came from my brother, who had gotten it secondhand. And he knew I would want to know, said one of my friends, they rushed him to the hospital and had a brain aneurysm, and he passed. And that was the first message I got, and it just bothered me, because I just saw him last week. I ate at his restaurant. He has one of those what you call soul food restaurants. And and it just troubled me, and so I passed the news on to someone else that just called right behind that. And then call came back and said that wasn't right. He did have a brain aneurysm. They rushed him to the hospital. He's going into surgery, and he's in critical condition. And that was better news, because that meant that he was still here. But it's evidence of the fact that you don't ever know when, where, or what. I tell the people where I preach that the takers are coming.
Yes, sir.
And they say, the takers? I said, oh, yeah, cancer,
yes, sir.
Leukemia,
mm-hmm.
car wreck, plane crash,
mm-hmm.
things that'll take you out of life. The takers are coming.
Mm-hmm.
And you don't know when, where, or why, or who, or what. Mm-hmm. You don't know anything. Can't control anything.
You're right.
And so it would behoove all of us to live circumspectly, whereby we exemplify the life of Christ every day. And so when the takers come for us, then we'll be ready. We'll be ready. So be in prayer for the Qualls family in Terrell. And I'm very prayerful tonight that my friend Ricky is going to be able to come through and continue on this side of the grave. So keep them in your prayers. But it is good to see all of you here tonight, and we're going to go back to the Word of God. I hope the message last night found good soil.
Yes, sir.
There's so many things in life to make you cry.
Amen.
And all you have to do is just keep living.
You're right.
And you keep living, you will experience things that will cause you to shed tears. But we take great consolation in what David said, weeping may endure for a night, but joy cometh in the morning.
Right.
How many of you have your Bibles with you tonight?
Yes,
I'm going to do a Bible check, and I graded on the curve last night. Amen.
Yes,
still got a few gaps. I'm going to give you an A tonight. No curve. No curve tonight. Maybe tomorrow night, Friday night, every person will have a Bible with you. Tonight, I'm going to go ahead and start so that I can get you out on time. I realize you have to work every day and go to school and you got all kind of things, so I'm going to try to be very kind tonight. I don't know if I will, but I'm going to try to be very kind tonight. I want to call your attention tonight to the book of 1 Samuel. I'm going to give you a few moments to try to find it now. 1 Samuel.
Yes, sir.
1 Samuel chapter 15. And I'm going to read quite a few verses, because you may not be familiar with this text, and I want you to understand exactly where we're going tonight.
Mm-hmm.
I announced on one day this week that I'm going to speak tonight on the subject Vox Populi, Vox Dei. Mm-hmm. And some of you, I heard somebody that night when I first said it, said, say what? Vox populi, vox dei. In the Roman Republic of 125 BC, there were two brothers. They were political reformers. And their names, Tiberius and Gaius Gracchus. And they wanted to put power in the hands of the people. And so their political mantra, their political theme, their political slogan was Vox Populi Vox Dei, which means the voice of the people is the voice of God. I took that saying, that slogan, that mantra, whatever you want to call it, and I inserted one word because I don't agree with the voice of the people being the voice of God.
All right, bro.
And so I put in there N-O-T, the voice of the people is not the voice of God.
All right.
And I use this message, and I like this sermon because I'm seeing, as you heard me elaborate last night, I'm seeing in our brotherhood and in our world, man having more authority than God gave him. I'm hearing a lot of things and seeing a lot of things, and I recited some of the things that I see as a preacher. I'm fortunate each year not only to preach for a good congregation in Fort Worth. I love where I preach. I've been there 20 years, and I've told them I ain't going nowhere. I've invested too much time and too much of my life into that church, and I love that church, and I tell them all the time, at Lake Como, we have nothing to worry about as far as false doctrine because I'm the vanguard. I'm going to watch closely for any sign of false doctrine entering into our assembly.
Right.
But I'm very fortunate to travel a lot, and I thank God for the opportunity and the privilege and the ability to travel and to speak and to visit different churches across the brotherhood, and whether you believe it or not, I literally juggle meetings, and I do as many meetings among our Anglo brethren as I do with the blacks, the African Americans, and I enjoy that because God doesn't see color.
Right.
Doesn't even care what color you are. He knows what color you are, but he doesn't matter to him. And so it's a joy to go and speak to them. I go to their encampments. I've been to the Red River Family Encampment up in New Mexico and Lake Tahoe, which is up in the mountains of California in Las Vegas, and another one in Redding, Pennsylvania, up in the hills, very cold place. That's all I can remember about it. It was chilly the whole time I was there, but I enjoy going, and I'm able to put my finger on the pulse of the thinking, the mentality of our brotherhood. And I'm seeing a lot of things and hearing a lot of things that are contrary to the teaching of God. And these things are happening because man is trying to speak louder than God. You see some things creeping into the worship service that God did not ordain.
Yes, sir.
You see women standing behind the pulpit preparing to preach a gospel sermon when God did not give her that role.
Right.
You see some women who are calling themselves preachers and leaders of the church when God did not design them to carry out that particular role.
Amen.
And we need to realize that men and women in the eyes of God are equal.
Yes, sir.
And yet God has given us different roles.
Yes, sir.
You can't understand that. Let me make it more plain for you. A woman is able to give birth to a baby.
Yeah. That's right.
A man cannot and will not and will never be able to procreate life by himself, give birth to a baby, carry a baby in his womb because man has no womb.
That's right.
God gave that role to women.
Amen.
God gave the man the role of caring for his family, providing for his family. And I often tell young ladies, and I want to drop this just as I begin this message, that when you look for a man, a mate, you go all the way back to the Genesis account.
Yes, sir.
And you look at Adam. Adam was given some things before he was given Miss Eve.
Yes, sir.
Adam had a home.
Yes, sir.
Adam had a job.
Yes, sir.
Adam had a good name.
Yes, sir.
Amen. He had responsibility. Yes. He had self-esteem. He had a lot of things that God gave him. And so, young ladies, when you looking for that man you want to spend the rest of your life with and you want to become one with, you make sure that man has a good name.
Yes, sir.
Has a home, has somewhere to take you. Don't let him marry you and take you to his mama's house.
Right. Real
I understand if it's just for a few days and y'all trying to get on your feet, but if brother man ain't on his feet, you might ought to take a second look at this fella.
Yes, sir.
Make sure he's got some respectability about him and responsibility. See, God gave us all different roles.
Yes, sir. Yes, sir.
And that is the man's role, and we're seeing men, especially African-American men, who are not fulfilling that role. You wonder why we have so much trouble in our world and in our race of people, and I deal with our race because I'm dealing with them every day. The African-American man is coming up missing.
Yes, sir.
Right.
Yes, sir.
I see him in prisons and in jails, and I see him hanging out on the corner with you know, Ray Ray and Pook in them and Bubba and all that. When they ought to be somewhere working, getting a job, trying to make something out of themselves. God gave them that role in life. And so when you're looking for somebody, make sure you look at them like you look at Adam and Eve. God gave Adam Eve, but Adam had some stuff before he got there. Amen. And let me drop this while passing through. This ain't part of the message, but you get caught up looking for Mr. Right.
Yes, sir.
Make sure you miss right.
Amen.
And vice versa.
Yes, sir.
You're looking for Miss Right. You make sure you miss the right. I tell churches sometimes that are looking for preachers and they got all these qualifications for the preacher, and he needs to be a family man with a PhD, and he's been at some church for 20, 30. If you find a man like that, why do you think he's looking for you?
Yes, sir. Yes, sir. Real plain. Real plain, bro.
And if you want a good preacher, make sure you are a good church.
Amen.
I tell preachers same thing. You're looking for the perfect church, no problems, no issues, no drama and all of that. Well, you make sure you don't bring any of that with you too.
Amen.
But anyway, that's not the message for tonight. Tonight I'm going to speak on this subject because I'm seeing some things in our brotherhood, and even here in Nashville I see some things that ought not be. And I want to talk tonight from the subject, the voice of the people is not the voice of God.
Amen.
I want to read these verses, and I want you to just be patient, and I'm going to try to do this within 35, 40 minutes tonight. I want to read this so that you'll get a feel for this. This is a very tragic story, 1 Samuel 15. Verse number 1, Samuel also said unto Saul, the Lord sent me to anoint thee to be king over his people, over Israel. Now therefore hearken thou unto the voice of the words of the Lord. Thus saith the Lord of hosts, I remember that which Amalek did to Israel, how he laid wait for him in the way when he came up from Egypt. Now go and smite Amalek and utterly destroy all that they have and spare them not. But slay both man and woman, infant and sucking, ox and sheep, camel and ass. And Saul gathered the people together and numbered them in Telaim, 200,000 footmen and 10,000 men of Judah. And Saul came to a city of Amalek and laid wait in the valley. And Saul said unto the Canaanites, go, depart, get you down from among the Amalekites, lest I destroy you with them, for you showed kindness to all the children of Israel when they came up out of Egypt. So the Kenites departed from among the Amalekites. And Saul smote the Amalekites from Havilah until thou comest to Shur, that is over against Egypt. And he took Agag, the king of the Amalekites, alive, and utterly destroyed all the people with the edge of the sword. But Saul and the people spared Agag, and the best of the sheep and of the oxen and of the fatlings and the lambs and all that was good, and would not utterly destroy them, but everything that was vile and refuse that they destroyed utterly. Then came the word of the Lord unto Samuel, saying, It repenteth me that I have set up Saul for to be king, for he is turned back from following me, and hath not performed my command, performed my commandments. And it grieved Samuel, and he cried unto the Lord all night. And when Samuel rose up early to meet Saul in the morning, it was told Samuel, saying, Saul came to Carmel, and behold, he set him up a place, and is gone about and passed on and gone down to Gilgal. And Samuel came to Saul, and Saul said unto him, Blessed be thou of the Lord, I have performed the commandment of the Lord. Is that in your Bible?
Yes, sir.
Put your finger there now.
Yes,
Saul said, I have performed the commandment of the Lord. And Samuel said, What meaneth then this bleating of the sheep in mine ears, and the lowing of the oxen which I hear? And Saul said, They have brought them from the Amalekites, for the people spared the best of the sheep and of the oxen to sacrifice unto the Lord thy God, and the rest we have utterly destroyed. Look at verse 20 quickly. And Saul said unto Samuel, Yea, I have obeyed the voice of the Lord, and have gone the way which the Lord sent me, and have brought Agag, the king of Amalek, and have utterly destroyed the Amalekites. But the people took of the spoil sheep and oxen, the chief of the things which should have been utterly destroyed, to sacrifice unto the Lord thy God in Gilgal. And Samuel said, Hath the Lord as great delight in burnt offerings and sacrifices as in obeying the voice of the Lord? Behold, to obey is better than sacrifice, and to hearken than the fat of rams. For the rebellion is as the sin of witchcraft, and stubbornness is as iniquity and idolatry, because thou hast rejected the word of the Lord. He hath also rejected thee from being king. I told you it was tragic, didn't it?
Yes, sir.
Verse 24, And Saul said unto Samuel, I have sinned, for I have transgressed the commandment of the Lord. In thy words, because I feared the people,